to the end. But I just need to help you to get to the end. Or in chapter 10, verse 22 and 23, he talks about them. Let us draw near with a true heart in full assurance of faith. Let us hold fast the profession of our faith without wavering. So Paul believes they can do it. Interestingly, Paul loves these brethren and sisters. He is one of them. He loves them. There's no part in this book where he says, oh, foolish Hebrews, like he does to the Galatians. Who's bewitched you? He loves them. They are true believers. But he is terrified for them. There is a moment coming in their life that the Apostle Paul is absolutely terrified about. Because up until now, they've been able to keep the law of Moses and believe in Jesus. It's been fine. James, we believe, did it. Peter kept it. Remember when Paul came back in the end of Acts, they said, can you keep the vows? So it was fine. You could keep the law and you could keep Jesus Christ. And these Hebrews were able to do this. Remember what Uncle Ron said? This isn't the Jerusalem Ecclesia. This is a subset of the Ecclesia. The Hebrews were a particular group in that Ecclesia. These were the ones who spent every day with their Bibles. Every Sabbath they were in the synagogue debating it, discussing it. And probably every day of the week they were still doing it. So they were still mixing with others who had not become believers yet. And Paul is saying, up until now you've been okay. You can believe in Jesus and you can keep the law. But there's a day coming, as Uncle Ron said, where you're going to have to make a choice. And we went to this quote with Uncle Ron, didn't we? Matthew chapter 24. There's going to be a day coming, Jesus says in his Olivet prophecy, where you're going to see the abomination of desolation, which Daniel spoke, standing in the holy place. That's the temple. And I've given you a command, get out of the city. So up until now, I can believe in Jesus. I can believe Jesus is the Son of God. I can believe he is Messiah. And I can keep the law and it's all okay. I can do that. That's fine. I'm a fine follower of Jesus Christ. I'll give away my house. I'll give away all my possessions. But there's a moment coming, Paul knows, where they're going to have to make a decision. There's a huge crossroads. Because at this point, when the Roman army pulls back from Jerusalem, they either decide we do what Jesus says and leave, or we don't do what Jesus says and we stay with this holy place. See how Daniel phrases it, that was the holy place that was going to get taken over by the Romans? Can you see the hugeness of that moment? So up until now, they hadn't really been challenged. They'd been challenged to be a follower of Jesus of Nazareth as Christ, but they could still keep the law. There was a moment coming, and it was a moment, maybe weeks or months, where they had to make a decision about whether they followed Jesus or whether they followed the law. And the consequences were dire. It wasn't that the Romans might kill them if they stayed there. That's what would happen. The Romans came back and finally destroyed the city. The consequences were that if they stayed in that city and didn't obey Jesus Christ, they were eternally dead. They were not saved. So can you see Paul's issue? Paul is saying, I know these brethren. I was one of them. At some stage, they have to decide to separate from the law. They haven't had to do that yet. They are going to get a moment when they either decide, I follow Jesus or I don't. It's going to be as clear as that. And he's terrified for their eternal salvation. He's saying, don't drift away from the doctrine, chapter 2. Just stay with the doctrine. Stay with what you heard. Don't let it slip. Don't let it drift away. You know, it's the same with us today, really. There's never a good time to... We need to be preparing right now for decisions that are going to come in the future. What Paul is giving them here is preparation for that time of the future. So the epistle to the Hebrews is, like I said, it's not written to a group of people who are going, oh, what does the Bible say? Oh, yeah, who cares? Oh, my life's all right. They loved God. They'd given up their life. What it is, it's almost like our Christadelphian instructor. Do you know the instructor? Who's meant to have learnt an instructor for tomorrow? Who's going to learn it on the way to the meeting, like we always used to when we were young? And probably most of you do. It's a bit like the Christadelphian instructor, right? They are going, these Hebrews, the subset of the Jerusalem Ecclesia, are going to go every week and they're going to be challenged by people who say, are you sure Jesus is Messiah? But hang on, what about the angels? Oh, here's 8 quotes to prove that Jesus is greater than the angels, Hebrews 1 and 2. Oh, yeah, but what about Moses, huh? What about Moses? Chapter 3, here's all the quotes about Moses. So the book of Hebrews is almost like the Christadelphian instructor for them. Here is a stack of quotes that they would understand that they can use not amongst themselves, but when people continually challenge their doctrine. And young people, it's exactly the same for us. The Christadelphian instructor, or understanding our doctrine, is vital. It is so easy to drift away. When that decision point comes, when there's that why in the road, when there's, do I do what Jesus says or I do not what Jesus says, do usually what I want to do, you don't have time to get out your Bibles. You don't have time then to brush up on your doctrine and understand it. You'll need to react to the challenge, and you don't have time to sit down with brethren and sisters and go over it carefully. Fill your mind now with the Christadelphian instructor, as it were. Because in those situations, you're going to need to pull on the word of God and go, yes, I can clearly see this. Right, Jesus Christ is absolutely perfect and right, I'll do exactly what he says. And if you're a bit unsure about what he said, you've lost the moment and you've lost that battle. You will be tried, young people. At some stage in your life, you're going to be tried around doctrine. What I've learnt in a short life in the truth, that every issue in ecclesial life usually comes back to doctrine, to an understanding of what God said in his Bible. And someone has to do the heavy lifting on what God said. And at that time, you're going to rely on other sisters and you're going to rely on other brethren. Make sure you're one of the ones that can be relied on to know exactly what the doctrine of the Bible is. Because you mightn't have time to sit down and work it all out. Someone's going to come to you and say, I've just heard a new idea. What do you reckon about, is Jesus God? You know, like, you know, they're not really saying Trinity, but they're saying some other stuff. Right? You need to be absolutely dead on clear. You can't go, give me a week, I'm going to read some of the Christadelphian works, I'll come back to you. So if there's any lesson to take out of this warning for us, it's understand your doctrine. Nearly every issue, you talk to the older brethren and sisters, these big ecclesial issues that you hear about, it all comes back to doctrine. Someone's misinterpreted the word of God. So understand your doctrine. When that decision point comes in your life, you'll be well in place to be able to answer, thus saith the Lord, and believe it with confidence. And you'll be able to tell your fellow brother or sister or young person who comes to you and say, look, I'm just wondering about this, you'll be able to give it dead on. But do it now and be ready. And that's Paul's warning for the Hebrews here. Don't let these things slip. As I think Weymouth said, don't let them just drift past you. You're just going along as a young person. It's all right. Let someone else do the heavy lifting and the doctrine's slipped away. And when the moment comes, you go, well, that sounds all right to me. You need to be able to not let these things slip. Now Paul contrasts the two messages, okay? So hold on to the message that the angels are giving of salvation. And he contrasts them. There's something which the angels spoke. It's the law of Moses, okay? So the law of Moses was spoken by angels. He says, verse 2, it was steadfast. So it was solid. And every transgression and every disobedience received a just reward. Does that sound like a pretty positive thing? It's not, is it? You know, look at Paul's words. There was an absolute law which the angels delivered. God gave it to the angel who gave it to Moses. The people couldn't see Moses. They didn't want to see the angel. Moses came out, his face was shining, and they said, oh, goodness. So it got passed down via the Levites to the people. That's the law that came from the angels. And every time you broke it and every disobedience, you got a just recompense of that reward. Okay? A just recompense. It just means a true judgment. You got what was coming to you. Look at the opposite. Verse 3. How shall we escape if we neglect so great a salvation? It's about being saved. This was confirmed by witnesses. So when Peter came out and spoke on the day of Pentecost, Well, actually, in fact, it was first... No, I don't have it there. Sorry, I missed one. It was first began to be spoken by the Lord. So this first, this great salvation, was first given by Jesus Christ. It was then confirmed by witnesses, Peter and the others. And God actually gave them the ability to do miracles to prove that this salvation was now the right thing. There was diverse miracles. And you got gifts of the Holy Spirit. You were given God's divine power when you believed this. And there would have been people in that ecclesia who had it, which came from Jesus' own will. See that at the end of verse 4? So you've got on one hand something which God gave to the angels who had to give it to Moses, who then wrote it down. We smashed the first lot. Then he wrote it down. It was given to the people. And every time you broke it, you died. And the angels made sure, well, you didn't die, sorry, you were punished. The angels made sure that that happened. And now there's a new thing. Jesus Christ is sitting at the right hand of God. And he walked this earth first and started telling people about salvation. And then he went to heaven. And the witnesses said that he went to heaven. And there's miracles and people are getting the Holy Spirit. And the angels are part of it. So which one do you want to believe? Because the Hebrews, when they got to Sabbath that week, might go, oh yeah, but... someone will say, yeah, but are you really going to make the angels angry by not doing what they said in the law? Well, when Jesus Christ died, this word spoken by angels was finished. God called all the angels back and said, come back. You know, all that where we had to, every transgression and disobedience would receive a just reward. That's finished now. I've got a new job for you. What's the new job? That's what Brother Greg said. Go out and bring great salvation to everyone. And it's the will of Jesus Christ. So why? Hebrews, don't be concerned. Why are you concerned that the angels may be upset with you if you break the law? They're not on the law anymore. That's finished. That job's done. They're all over here giving salvation. So don't neglect so great a salvation. So can you see the warning there that Paul has provided for them? All right, so now we're back into the angels. We've got through the first four verses. Verse 5, for unto the angels hath he not put in subjection the world which is to come. So that's his next point he's going to make, Hebrews chapter 2, verse 5. Now, what I want to do here, and that sheet that you have somewhere near you, well, may help you do this. It's really a framework of looking at citations, not just Paul in Hebrews, but citations anywhere in Scripture. Now, a citation, if you don't know, is a citation is a quote from the Old Testament that's in the New Testament. Okay? It's often, if you've got a margin like mine, which is the Oxford Bible, it said cited from in the margin, all right? Great things to write in. We get cross-references where we think, oh, Paul might be referring to over here. That's different. A citation is where it says, and I quote, word for word. Uncle Greg had several last class for us. So here's a bit of a framework. How do you understand a citation? First of all, you just got to know where the quote came from. So that's the first question we're going to ask. Then, what is its context? So let's go back to where that quote was. What's the context that God put it in originally? So Paul's looking at it. You know, what was the context that was in? You've got to understand that. Now, why has Paul used that quote in that context in Hebrews? Does that make sense? So Paul didn't just willy-nilly go, there's some nice words. I'll just pop them in. No, he's using it in a context because Paul is writing, but he's writing by the power of God. So what is the context and why is that relevant to the Hebrews? And then finally, is there a lesson for us? So there may not be. Don't just jump to, okay, what's the lesson we can find out of what Paul's quoted from the Old Testament? First of all, apply it to the people he's writing to, the Hebrews. Then we can see if there's a lesson for us. So there's four we're going to do tonight. I've given you five because you might find another one or you might want to practice on the way home. But look, there's other ways of looking about how to understand citations, but you are going to get a lot of them through Hebrews this year. This is one way of doing it. But you really need, I guess we're saying, is understand the context and stick with Paul's explanation of the Bible context. Now, as you go through Hebrews, you might start asking this question. Oh, I reckon Paul's citations are a bit stretched, aren't they? He's applying a scripture in the Old Testament, but like, really? He's applying it? Well, the answer is yes, really, because he's got the power of God, okay? So you might have me say something. I reckon that it's coming here from Genesis, and you go, oh, no, I don't think so. Paul is quoting, and he's got the power of God, all right? Here's a quote from a brother Morris. He said, to us, certain of the foregoing quotations may appear a little strained or stretched, not perhaps the sort of text we'd look to nowadays for seeking to convince our friends of a doctrinal truth. So if you wanted to prove that Christ is more important than angels, you mightn't use these. Yet Paul knew his readers. He knew that they were steeped in the Psalms and the prophets, and they, like him, had studied every small allusion to Messiah. They could hardly fail to acknowledge that even in such relatively obscure phrases, and we're going to get a corker tonight, was compelling evidence to qualify Jesus as Messiah, mediator, and high priest. Okay, so bear that in mind as you go through the rest of Hebrews. That's Brother Morris writing in the Christadelphian about 40 years ago. Great set of articles if you are looking. Brother Greg recommended Brother Carter. And certainly if you've read Brother Carter and you want something else, go and look it up. I don't think it's in print, but you can get it on the CD thing if you know what they are. Whatever it is, the thing. All right, you'll find it there. Brother Morris. So understand that. Yeah, look, it might look stretched to us, but understand these people ate, lived, and breathed the Old Testament. They've now believed that Jesus is Messiah. They've put it all together. They spent every day just going over their scriptures, and literally probably every day. These were Hebrews. They didn't have another job. Their whole job was to pull the Bible apart. As I said, it's not the whole Jerusalem Ecclesia. They knew them all. So let's start on the first one. You can get your piece of paper out if you want, or you can screw it up and sit on it and decide to use it later if you want, but it's a way of putting it in. You might want to put it straight into your margin. Righto, so as Jay read for us, the point he's making is that the angels, the world to come, so the future age has not been put in subjection to under subjection to the angels. The angels aren't in control of it. Verse 6, but one in a certain place testified saying, and then we get a full quote. So the first thing we need to write in is where the quote comes from. I can ask you all, and you'll all sit quietly, and probably most of you may have worked it out. Your margin's really helpful here. Psalm 8. Right, so that's the first bit. It comes from Psalm 8. So next thing on our thing, what do we need to do? What's its context? Let's pop something in Hebrews and go back to Psalm 8. As I said, there's only four of these tonight, so we'll toddle through them and see if we can just pick up the brilliance of God, but Paul writing to prove this point. Psalm 8, really a famous psalm, a psalm we believe is given around the incidents of Goliath. So what Paul needs to prove here is that Jesus Christ is superior to the angels. Some of them might have been saying, yeah, Jesus, look, he's very good. He's like an angel, you know. He really is like an angel. Uncle Greg showed that by his birth, he was superior to the angels. Now we're going to see in this chapter, by his suffering and death, he is way superior to anything that's ever touched this earth. And he starts in Psalm 8. So instead of just taking them back to Jesus, he's going to take them a long way back. Let's look at this. Just see if you can pick up any language that's come back from further back in the Bible. Let's start with verse 3. When I consider thy heavens, talking to God, the work of thy fingers, the moon and the stars which thou hast ordained, what is man that thou art mindful of him? And the son of man, so one particular man that thou hast visited him. Where does that language kind of put us? I consider the heaven, the work of thy fingers, the moon, the stars which thou hast ordained, put in place. Way back to creation, isn't it? So Hebrews and the people you're talking to, Jesus, as Uncle Greg said, as part of God's plan from before creation. But let me take you back to creation via Psalm 8 to prove that Jesus in the age to come will be he has more power and is over the angels. So way back at the beginning when there was creation, what's man that thou art mindful of him? The son of man that thou visit him? For thou hast made him a little lower than the angels. Hebrews, see? If Jesus is one of men, the son of man, this particular person, the one son of man that's going to come, isn't he lower than the angels? So that the angels gave us the law, so really we should listen to the angels. He's going to explain that. He was made him, created him, a little lower than the angels, and has crowned him with glory and honour, and made him have dominion over the works of thy hands. Thou hast put all things under his feet. And he goes on with the ideas of creation. This is Genesis chapter 1, verse 26. God, Adam and Eve, he said to them, you'll have dominion over all things, the beasts, the field, the creeping. You've got dominion over them all. What happened is Adam and Eve sinned, didn't they? And the angels had to go back to work to provide salvation. But the Son of Man was made a little lower than the angels, but by something he did, God crowned him with glory and honour, and he has dominion over everything. Now, end of verse 6, he's put all things under his feet. Oh, goodness, what is all things? There's a couple of things we need to know here. How was Jesus a little lower than the angels? I thought he was really, didn't Uncle Greg say he was really important? But how is he lower than the angels in creation? And all things under his feet. So Jesus, doesn't that just mean he's in charge of the sheep and the cattle and everything? When the kingdom comes, he'll be there. But the angels will still be more important than him. Well, we don't need to worry, because Paul explains that for us. Verse 8. Hebrews chapter 2, verse 8. Thou hast put all things in subjection under his feet. Now Paul starts explaining it. He says, for in that he put all in subjection under, he let nothing that is not put under him. That includes the angels. So that all things there, just when you think, does it really matter to really look at your Bibles? All things, Paul makes a point here, means all things including angels. So that's vital. But Paul says it's very evident we don't now see everything put under him. It's still Romans, they're still ruling. There's even the high priest still ruling. So that's still happening. We don't see all that happening. But we see Jesus, verse 9, who was made a little lower than the angels. Oh, good, he's going to explain to us how Jesus is lower than the angels. For the suffering of death, crowned with glory. So the only respect in which Jesus is lower than the angel is because he could die. We're going to come back to that in a moment. Okay, so see how we can use Paul to interpret Psalm 8. So what's the context of Psalm 8? David, you can write down whatever you want. This is sort of the way I put it in. David's explaining the position of humans from the beginning was to have dominion. I'll put all things under your feet. But it can only be accomplished through the Son of Man. Who's the Son of Man that you visited him? So only one will be able to accomplish putting all things, including angels, under his feet. Okay, so it's Psalm 8, isn't it? Go right back to creation. God made man to have dominion, and that dominion is going to come through someone called the Son of Man, who's going to be crowned with glory and honour. Why does Paul use that quote in Hebrews? Was that a good one? Well, because of the power and the victory of the Son of Man, that's Jesus, all things, including the angels, are subject to him. See how he's used that? He said, right from creation, everything was put in subjection to men. One man's going to make that happen. It's called Jesus, we're going to see in the next verse. And that means the angels are subject to Jesus. Verse 9, we saw that why he was so great. We see Jesus, who was made a little lower than the angels for the suffering of death, crowned with glory and honour. My next point, Jesus is so great because he could sin and die. The angels couldn't get everything under the dominion of the feet of men. It is only the work of Jesus Christ, young people, the death and the resurrection of Jesus Christ, that has enabled all things to be under the feet of Jesus Christ, to bring everything back as God intended it. An angel was not powerful enough to do that. Get his point? Because an angel can't die. And before that, an angel can't sin. We're going to look at how by him sinning, he was able to, by him being able to sin, he was able to destroy death a little later in the chapter. But an angel was powerless to be able to do this work because it couldn't sin and they can't die. So Paul's taken them via Psalm 8 way back to creation and said Jesus was right in this. The Son of Man, not the Son of God or the Son of an angel, the Son of Man, it has to be a man. Is there a lesson for us? The end of verse 9, Jesus Christ, that by the grace of God he should taste death for every man. What was the problem? Adam and Eve sinned. God wanted someone perfect to live before him. Adam and Eve had sinned. So God said, if you sin, you will die. They had to die. Their children had to die. And God was right that we all die. God said, the only way to break this, if someone comes along and doesn't sin. And he looked and there was no one. And he sent his own son, born of a woman, the Son of Man and the Son of God. He came and he lived a perfect life. And God says, I love that life. But you're born of a woman, therefore you will die. And when he died, he completed a perfect life. And God goes, I love that life. You lived the same life as every other man and you have showed that I am right. It is worthy of death. And because you've done that, you'll be raised to life everlasting. And why did that happen? Because God had to fulfill a formula? No. By the grace of God. Because God loved us, because he has grace, he sent his own son. You know, this is the key point of tonight. So we're told as speakers to try and give you one exhortational point to take away. We've done the one on doctrine, stick with your Bibles. Here's another one. I don't quite know how to express this. Young people, just this lesson will come to you greater and greater every week and every month of your life. If you stick with the doctrine, you will truly appreciate Jesus Christ. And you will never be confused about his position, about whether he's greater or less than an angel, about whether he's greater or less than Moses or Joshua. Because you will be in outstanding awe of a man who could sin in every way that we can sin and never did. And as every day you finish your day praying for forgiveness because you have sinned, and every week you come along here and you take the bread and the wine, if you're baptized, or you see others do that and realize you've made the same mistakes again. And every year you think about it, you will just grow in outstanding awe of a man who walked this earth with exactly the same feelings you have and never sinned. And you will love him and you will love his Father that he sent someone to this earth and gave him the same trials we have to save us. He made him live through that we may have life. I'm sorry, I really can't explain anymore. Some of you will have well felt it already. It will grow through your life. Make sure it does. Never live a life of blasphemy to Jesus Christ. Here is the greatest individual that ever touched this earth because he could sin and he never did. And because he could die, and he suffered and died because his Father wanted him to and because he loves you. That's the lesson for us. Now, the Hebrews were wonderful people. But by wanting to turn back to the law or getting to that decision point and decide, do I follow Jesus who did this for me or I go back to the law, they actually hadn't realized the grace of God, had they? That God sent his Son that we may have life. You know, the sufferings of Jesus Christ are probably best expressed in Hebrews. In fact, I really think they are. Like, 1 Peter speaks more about suffering than any other book, But if we didn't have Hebrews, think about what we didn't know about the sufferings of Jesus Christ. If you want to understand the greatness of Jesus Christ, young people, Hebrews, if you want to understand how great Jesus is, you've got to see him suffer. I'm just going to read this. It's really big, but you'll get some idea about this. Just a collation by Brother Morris again. Here's quotes from Hebrews that tell us about the suffering of Christ we wouldn't know about if it wasn't for Hebrews. We see Jesus, who was made a little lower than the angels for the suffering of death, taste death for every man, perfect through sufferings. For in that he hath suffered being tempted, he's able to succour them that are tempted. He was touched with the feeling of our infirmities, tempted like as we are, offered up prayers and supplications with strong crying and tears, learned obedience by the things which he suffered. We wouldn't know this from the Gospels. Nor yet that he should offer himself often, for then he must have suffered since the foundation of the world. So Christ was once offered to bear the sins of many, who for the joy that was set for him endured the cross, despising the shame, endured such contradiction of sinners against himself. For whom the Lord loveth, he chasteneth. Wherefore Jesus also, that he might sanctify the people with his own blood, suffered without the gates. It's a really nice way of actually wrapping up something, isn't it? Just pulling all those ideas of suffering together and seeing that if we didn't have Hebrews, we'd know a lot less about Jesus' suffering. You know, our classes tonight, and the issue with for the Hebrews is we're proving that Jesus was better than the angels, better than Moses, better than the law. Don't be confused by that. We're not saying that there's a sort of scale here, and you've got Jesus here, and the angels are just under him now. Then we've got Moses, other people, and then God at the top. You know, it's a scale. The sufferings of Jesus Christ, being able to walk this earth and never sin, puts him off the scale. There is no scale. If you want to draw a scale, brethren and sisters and young people, it's Moses, Joshua, Paul, angels, Jesus and God, and they're together. There is nothing in between. Don't sort of get the idea that we use the word better. Oh, he's a bit better than this, he's a bit. There is no comparison. In fact, without Jesus Christ, there is no Moses. There is no angels. There is no Paul. There is no Joshua. There is no Lord. Jesus is everything. And Jesus and God in Hebrews are presented as one. I don't need to deal with the Trinity. Brother Greg did it last class. Thank you. They're one. And you know the phenomenal thing about Hebrews? Is Hebrews is saying they're one. Paul's saying, and they want you there with them. Why are you fussing around over here? That's the message of Hebrews. So don't ever underestimate the power of Jesus Christ, the power of his sufferings, because he could sin and never did. That's why he's totally off the scale. All right, so we got to the end of verse 9. Now, just in case you're wondering, should I follow this or not? Verse 10. So Hebrews, you know, is Jesus really more important than the angels? For it became him for whom are all things and by whom are all things. Well, I'll tell you whose plan it is, Paul says. It's God's plan, okay? So God, by whom are all things, and became him for whom are all things and by whom are all things, so God, in bringing many sons to glory to make the captain of their salvation perfect through suffering. It's God's plan. So if you think, well, it's a bit of a silly plan, which the Jews did, this is foolishness. How would Messiah die? Why would Messiah? It's foolishness. Were you worried about that? It's God's idea. So that's who you can go and talk to about the foolishness of his plan. But he wanted to make the captain of their salvation. Captain's someone who plays with you, isn't he? Captain's someone who leads you with you. There's not an angel that we don't understand and can never see saying, do this. It's Jesus Christ who lived exactly as we did. He never sinned. We're in awe because he never sinned. But he lived with us and says, do this. Follow me. He's the captain of our salvation. And we can follow him to salvation. That's what it's all about, being saved. Verse 11 says, for both he that sanctifieth, that's Jesus Christ, he who makes us holy, so both Jesus and they who are sanctified, that's us, so both Jesus and us are all of one God. We're all of God. What does that mean? Well, if God is the father of Jesus and the father of us, people who share the same father are brothers, for which cause he is not ashamed to call them brethren. See where Paul's got to now? So if we're involved in this great salvation by the grace of God who's sanctifying us, and it's his plan, and it was his plan that the captain of salvation should be one of us, well, we're brothers, because God is the father of us both. That's good logic, but it's not good enough for the Hebrews. So we're going to go into three more quotes now. Saying, so here's the quotes. Quotes are to prove we are the brothers of Jesus Christ. He's not ashamed to call them brethren. This is a little aside before we jump into the quote. Do you know that Jesus never called us brethren? Or never called the disciples brethren? He referred to them as brethren in the third person. You are my brother and sister if you do what I want. The time he began calling them brethren was in Matthew chapter 28. And he said to the women in the garden, be not afraid, go tell my brothers, go and tell my brethren that they go into Galilee and there they will see me. Oh, that's interesting. So up until that point, Jesus hadn't called them brothers until the resurrection. Why is that? Because he hadn't suffered. Because until that point, God was his father, but we weren't united in that family. If you think, oh, Uncle Pete, stretching it. Look what he says to Mary in the Garden of Gethsemane. Jesus said to her, touch me not, for I'm not yet ascended to my Father, but go to my brethren and say unto them, I ascend unto my Father, and for the first time, your Father. I have now, through my sufferings, opened a way whereby we are one family. And to my God and your God. God was always our God. He wasn't our Father. It is only through the work of Jesus Christ, through the suffering and resurrection of Jesus Christ, that we can come into that family, that we can be baptized into his death and resurrection and be part of that family. So the first time Jesus Christ calls us brethren, or those who he spent 3.5 years with brethren, is after his suffering. Just a good little note on the side, those two quotes. Okay. Now we can get into the next citation. Where's the quote from? Saying, I will declare thy name unto my brethren. In the midst of the ecclesia will I sing praise unto thee. Psalm 22, verse 22. So you might have it there in your margin. If not, just pop that in or put it on your piece of paper. So we're going to stay in the Psalms. Psalm 22. Psalm 22, famous psalm. Hopefully some of us are going, oh yeah, Psalm 22. That's the psalm about Jesus suffering. Oh, that's an interesting psalm for Paul to choose. Don't forget, the next question is, what's its context? This is the psalm, Psalm 22. Let's read verse 22. I always like to do this just to make sure that Paul's right. I will declare thy name unto my brethren in the midst of the congregation. Yep, okay, good. Paul got the right quote. Great. Now, what's the psalm about? Verse 1. My God, why hast thou forsaken me? Why art thou so far from helping me? Here's Jesus on the cross, remember? These are the words, on the cross. I'm calling to God, but I feel abandoned. All the people that see me laugh me to scorn. This is what they say, verse 8. He trusted in Yahweh that he would deliver him. Let him deliver him, seeing he delight in him. So hopefully we know this psalm. But thou art he, verse 9, that took me out of the womb. From before I was born, you were the one that cared for me. Thou didst make me hope when I was upon my mother's breasts. I was cast upon thee from the womb. Thou art my God from my mother's belly. Be not far from me, for trouble is near. There is none to help. And there wasn't. Paul wasn't there to help. The Hebrews weren't there to help. They were saying, he's a criminal, crucify him. But here we have the Messiah saying, the only person I can trust from my birth is you, God. You're the only one that I can trust. No one else is helping me. They compass me about. There's no one to help me. Verse 20, Verse 19, be not far from me, O Yahweh, O my strength, haste thee to help me. He's on the cross, he's about to die. God, help me, but not my will, but thy be done. Deliver my soul, verse 20, from the sword, my darling, from the power of the dog. Darling just means only one. Save me from the lion's mouth. And then you can put a little thing in the psalm there, because he's asking to be saved from the lion's mouth, from death. Look at the end, next part of the verse. For thou hast heard me from the horns of the unicorns. God, you heard me. I'm now raised. Actually, the psalm pivots on that little point. Save me. You've heard me. I will declare thy name unto my brethren. In the midst of the congregation will I praise thee. Who are his brethren? Oh, they're the ones he couldn't trust because he had to rely on his God when he was born because his brothers weren't there. He's not ashamed to call us brethren. We should just be ashamed that he even thinks of us as part of his family. He died because we weren't there for him. The brethren there, think about the Hebrews reading this. Yeah, that's right. He died because we didn't stand up. We said, crucify him, crucify him. And now he wants to call us brethren. Ye that fear Yahweh, praise him, ye the seed of Jacob. And he goes on to say that the whole earth, end of Psalm 22, is going to praise him, praise God, and they will praise Jesus, verse 31, they shall come, it's talking about people in ages to come, and shall declare his righteousness unto a people that shall be born, that's us, that he hath done this, that Jesus Christ has accomplished it, that the work has been done, that God and Jesus work together, and we have salvation. So, couple of points. What's its context? It's a psalm of the sufferings Messiah went through so he could accomplish God's word, will. It's a suffering psalm. Why does Paul use that in Hebrews? Yeah, there's lots of other psalms about how we're happy to be his brethren. It proves Messiah had to suffer before he could fulfill God's will. See, the suffering part comes before verse 22. After the suffering, verse 21, I will declare thy name amongst thy brethren. And it's only after his suffering that he will call us brethren. So, is perfected through suffering. Jesus Christ greater than the angels. Oh, yeah, he is off the scale because he suffered. Angels can't do that. They're not powerful enough. Is there a lesson for us? Yeah, we need to be in awe of the price that's been paid, of the price paid to be part of God's family. Hi, brother. Hi, sister. Yeah, I'm a brother of Christ. I'm a Christadelphian. Remember the price paid for that. Think very carefully before you say, I'm a Christo. Yeah, I'm one of them, I'm a Christo. I saw some Christos the other day. Personally, it irks me tremendously. He's not ashamed to be called a Christadelphian. Just remember that when we throw off about being a brother or sister of Jesus Christ. He's not ashamed to be called that. Remember the price that was paid by the Father and by the Son that we can be called his brothers. Brothers of Jesus, brothers of Christ, Christadelphians. Okay, Paul goes, yeah, but you're going to need another instructor quote because that's not enough. I'll give you another one. Now, here's a real corker. Whoops. So we want to prove that Jesus he wants us to be our brothers. He's not ashamed to call us brethren. And again, I will put my trust in him. What's that got to do with brethren? Goodness gracious. What's that all about? Well, it's a quote from 2 Samuel chapter 22, verse 3, or Psalm 18. So Psalm 18 is an exact replica of 2 Samuel 22. So we'll go to Psalm 18 because it's closer to Psalm 22, and we can just use that instead. So Psalm 18, stick with me here. I only got another one quote to go in this set. Then your sheet's full. Okay, what's its context? Well, Psalm 18, we can't read it all, but Psalm 18, or 2 Samuel 22, it's about the psalmist relying on God to deliver him from death. I will love thee, verse 1, O Yahweh, my strength. Yahweh is my rock, my fortress, my deliverer, my God, my strength, in whom I trust. Okay, that's the quote that Paul uses. What's all this about? He said, Verse 4, the sorrows of death compass me. The floods of ungodly men made me afraid. The sorrows of hell compass me round about. So here's David. We know Jesus, as a psalmist, is it's messianic. He's being surrounded by his enemies. It's all pressing down on him. And he calls to God, his rock. And the psalm's phenomenal. It's one of those great psalms where it says, God heard in heaven, and he rose up, and he got the clouds like his chariot, and he came flying down from heaven with great thunderbolts like arrows, and shook the earth, and grabbed his son, who was dead, and ripped him out of the cold earth, and said, because you suffered, you're going to sit beside me. And he grabbed his son out of the cold earth, and where did he put him? Sorry, I have it here somewhere. He put him in a wide and open place. Verse 19, he brought me forth also into a large place. He delivered me because he delighted in me. There's not many wider places, safer wider places, where you're not going to get attacked than heaven, is there? He picked him up and put him in heaven. Because you followed me, I will do that. Verse 20, Yahweh rewarded me according to my righteousness, according to the cleanliness of my hands, hath he recompensed me. So why does this quote prove that we're brothers of Jesus? Because he trusted in God. Look how he says, this is how I put my trust in God. Verse 2, Yahweh is my rock, my fortress, my deliverer, my God, my strength, in whom I trust. That's the quote. My buckler, the horn of my salvation, and my high tower. Do you think he trusted in God? Think of all the terms he says. I'm going to get killed, I'm going to die, but God's my... He trusted in God. And that makes him our brother. Because the only way we are a part of the family of God is if we trust in God as well. Why does Paul use it in Hebrews? Because it proved I had to rely on God, his Father, to overcome any obstacle, just like the Hebrews did. That's why he's their brother. That's the point, see? Jesus Christ is off the scale, but he's also like you, Hebrews. He had to rely on God to get him out of the grave. He had to rely on God in every situation of his life. Being the Son of God did not make him independent of God. It made him reliant on God. And that's what's remarkable. What's the lesson for us? Is there a lesson for us? Well, when we're stuck in a situation, the formula is exactly the same. We need to rely on God. We need to pray to God and seek for his help, for his forgiveness if we're baptized. We need to rely on our Father just like Jesus did, and we can overcome any obstacle with him. So a really obscure psalm, but see, when you pull the context together, it is really quite remarkable. Jesus Christ had to pray to God for help, just like his brothers and sisters have to. But we need another quote for the instructor. There's not enough here. And again, in the verse 13, behold, I and the children which God hath given me. Where's the quote from? So Isaiah 8, verse 18. What is its context? Isaiah 8, verse 18. Behold, I and the children whom Yahweh hath given me. He's quoted. 8 verse 18. But we are for signs and wonders in Israel from Yahweh of hosts, which dwelleth in Mount Zion. Okay, so what's the context? You can scan through it, but Isaiah actually was told, go and have a child. And you're going to call the child a remarkable name. You're going to call him Maashalahashbaz. Great for Bible trivia quizzes. Maashalahashbaz. And it means that the time is coming of God's judgment. And he says, you... Isaiah, and your children are for signs to faithless Israel. Look how faithless Israel is. Verse 18, I and the children who God have given me. Verse 19, and when they say unto you, seek unto them that have familiar spirits, unto wizards that peep and that mutter, should not a people seek unto their God? for the living to the dead? So Israel at the time is religiously following sorcery. To the law and to the testimony, says Isaiah, or God. If they speak not according to this word, it's because there's no light in them. So you boys, you family, are going to be assigned to people who don't believe the Bible properly. They're off believing all sorts of weird incantations. But get back to your Bible. Don't drift from the doctrine. Stick with the doctrine. What's the context? Isaiah and his sons are chosen to be signs for faithless Israel, that God is working according to his plan, just as his testimony said. Why does Paul use it to the Hebrews? Well, Jesus and the Hebrews have been chosen to be signs to Israel, faithless Israel, that God is working just like he said in the Old Testament. Here's a stack of four quotes for your instructor to prove Jesus is just fulfilling what God always said from the beginning. Is there a lesson for us? I think there is. We're signs for everyone around us that the Bible's just going as it always was going to. What God said at the beginning is going to happen. Jesus Christ is going to return. And God's will be established through this whole earth, and anyone who wants salvation can have it. So there you go. That's the interesting way that Paul, in remarkable style, goes back, looks at those contexts and brings things out of them. So as we conclude now, we end up with this section which we're not going to deal with every verse. We've sort of dealt with the sufferings of Jesus Christ. But this verse is here, verse 14 through to the end, talks about how Jesus Christ overcame. And we said that because he was able to suffer. He was able to live a life exactly the same as us, but without sin. Verse 14, for as much then as the children are partakers of flesh and blood, he also himself likewise took part of the same, that through death he might destroy him that had the power of death, that is the devil, and deliver them who through fear of death, that's us, were all their lifetime subject to bondage. So Jesus Christ took on himself our nature. He's not an angel. The angels couldn't do that. He took on himself our nature, the same stuff that makes you and me sin. He had every day and didn't sin. When did Jesus take on this nature? You know, it was a clear decision that Jesus made. Scripture said it was a clear decision. Here's Philippians. He emptied himself, taking the form of a servant, being made in the likeness of men. He humbled himself, becoming obedient to death. Wherefore God hath highly exalted him. Though he was rich, yet for your sakes he became poor. When did Jesus decide to take on our nature? Because that's how it presents it, isn't it? He did it, he made a choice to do that. He was born, he didn't have a choice. There wasn't a point in Jesus' life where he said, right now, God said, no, angel or son of Abraham, what do you want to be? Oh, I'll do son of Abraham. He didn't have a choice. But he made it his choice. And there's a huge lesson in that for us young people. These quotes show that Jesus Christ accepted what God had given him for him and didn't say, oh, God, why did you make it so hard for me? This is just a hard life. Look at them. They don't have the expectations I have. Oh, it's too hard. He took it on himself and made that choice. Just like us young people. We may not have made the choice to be. We might have been born in a Christadelphian family. Have you ever found yourself saying, oh, man, why is it so hard? I wish I could do what they're doing. They don't seem to have any conscience. It'd be heaps easier. Those people over there, they never care. Oh, I'm a Christadelphian. I've got to go along. I'm a brother of Christ. God, why have you made it so hard for me? He was made perfect through his sufferings. He felt those things, but he accepted it as his choice. Make it your choice that you're here this evening. Make it your choice that you're at the meeting tomorrow morning. Don't feel that life's just pushed you into the truth and you don't have any options. You do have an option, and it's just a horrific one. So take the choice that you've been given and embrace it like our Lord did. He chose to live like us so that he could save us. Choose to live a positive, helpful, godly life to help the rest of the people in this hall. And in doing that, Jesus Christ was able to destroy him that has the power of death, that is the devil. Yeah, it's not a supernatural devil with horns, is it? We know that. And if we don't, ask someone. But it's not. And do you know what? A supernatural devil with horns and a pitchfork, it's really just a pussycat, isn't it, compared to what we deal with every day. It's a powder puff compared to what we wake up with every morning. The power of death that haunts us every day, young people. From the moment we wake up, that power that says, don't start your day with prayer, you're too tired. Don't do a reading this morning, just check your social media instead. Maybe look at the news, probably something important's happened. Don't put a talk on or read a good book as you go to school or go to work. Chill out with some inane babblings from the world on commercial radio. That's what we've got to fight against. When you're offended at college or when you're offended at work, lash back at the person to show who's boss, to show that you're not going to get pushed around. That's who we're fighting against. The thing in our life that says, make some cutting remark. Next time you're on social media, make some cutting remark on Facebook about a friend or like something that really you wouldn't be seen dead liking if Jesus was with you. It's that thing we fight against that when mum or dad come to give us some input to our life or our day, to give us some helpful advice, we tell them that, oh, you never understood anyway, and storm off, and we don't even know why we stormed off and why we're cross with them. That's what we're fighting against. Devil with pitchfork and horns, pussycat. It's that thing that when we have an hour to spare at the end of the day, tells us, hey, just waste it mindlessly. Watch things you're actually appalled by and you'd hate to have Jesus watch with you, but do it anyway. And we end up at the end of our day going, what happened to our day? And we stand in awe of the man who lived with all those temptations and never once gave into them. For 33 years, he starved his flesh and eventually died and hung it on a tree to show his Father that he loved him and that he loves us. And therefore, he is able to be a perfect high priest. He's off the charts. He's not on the same charts as us. He is off those charts. He is the perfect high priest. You're going to deal with high priests to come. He's the perfect high priest that we can rely on. And we're going to conclude with this, because Paul does. Hebrews chapter 13. Let your conversation be without covetousness, and be content with such things as ye have. For he hath said, I will never leave thee nor forsake thee. So that we may boldly say, the Lord is my helper. That's the word that the Lord will succour us. He'll run to help us. The Lord will come and help us. Remember them which have the rule over you, have spoken unto you the word of God, whose faith follow, considering the end of their conversation. Jesus Christ the same yesterday and today and forever. The same Jesus Christ that 2,000 years ago lived a perfect life and now is in heaven and has given the angels that are in this room charge over your salvation, young people, is exactly the same. They will ensure our salvation. Everything has been done. There is nothing more that God can do for us, is there? It is up to us.